Coolpad cementing their legacy? Eh? A while back, I promised to spend a little more time with less expensive phones, and Coolpad sent over a $40 Lumina for me to play with. So we shouldn't make fun. It was a functional device for 40 bucks, and maybe that's all someone might be able to afford. Many of us in this tech space are spoiled by products in significantly higher price brackets. Following up on that last review, Coolpad sent out another device. Still near the entry level, but much higher up the food chain. The Coolpad Legacy sells for $180 on Metro by T-Mobile, and I'm really happy to report that cheap phones are getting really nice. I commented in the Illumina review that a few ideas there seemed cribbed from Lumias like the 520, but similar hardware from the Lumia days could be had for a lot less now. The Legacy takes that idea and uses better Lumia phablets as the inspiration. The construction feels like the love child of a Lumia 925 and a Lumia 640 XL. I'm obviously being a bit cheeky. I don't think Coolpad set out to knock off an old Windows phone, but they are picking up some good ideas that the rest of the smartphone market has discarded. You know, this is the phablet size, but it's in a modern 2:1 aspect ratio screen. There's a metal frame and a plastic back. Combination of materials which still feels premium, but is also less expensive to implement. A consumer should not be punished for paying less. And in some situations, this might prove more durable than a glass back. Not a small consideration for a budget device for a consumer who might struggle with high technology costs. Looking at the spec sheet, I was a bit skeptical. I've never been much impressed by the Snapdragon 400 series devices, but that opinion is starting to turn, where I was much happier last year with phones like the Moto G6 than I would have thought. No one would confuse this chipset with a premium pocket computer, but I don't hate my life on the 450 with Android. I'm not trying to drive graphics intense games or render a ton of video, but I have plenty of horsepower for handling communication, social media. The screen is decent enough for that multimedia use. It's a solid mini tablet with an LTE connection. So propping it up and writing a script with a Bluetooth keyboard was better than fine. Watching a video, plugging in some headphones to the built-in headphone jack, it's more than capable for entertainment. Better, it's a great option for longer run situations. You know, this big screen is balanced by a low power chip and a big battery. Now, considering the target demographic and the use case, this is easily a two-day phone with moderate use. Plus, Quick Charge 3 is supported to help top off the larger capacity in a reasonable amount of time. There are no missteps here, and these are awesome specs at this price tier. The dual cameras on the rear are competent, but that is one of the few areas where the Legacy feels like its budget price tag. I wouldn't lean too hard on the shooter, but it is a dual lens system. Photos aren't bad, but they are budget. It's one of the few spots we'd call a compromise, though it is better than just functional. We get some fun budget perks like portrait mode and a night mode and 1080p video with some software stabilization. Lastly, we might expect a budget device to receive lackluster support. I can't comment on long-term potential for a brand like Coolpad, but the phone comes out of the box with Pi, and it was one of the first in my stable of review handsets to get the May security patch. It's not a branded Android One device, so we'll have to see if they can continue pushing out updates on a swift timeline, but early use has been promising. The last point, and I want to return to this, is price. $180 full retail. Now, cheap phones face continued pressure from older flagship phones, and this is near the ballpark of a used V30 or Galaxy S8. Obviously, in terms of hardware, those are nicer devices, but you'd have to buy them used. They likely won't get much, if any, future software support, and neither have anywhere near this battery performance. We shouldn't ignore that the Coolpad has also gone on sale, where it's been seen around 130. And if you sign up for Metro, you can get it for 30 bucks right now. There's something really charming about buying a whole phone for less than the price of replacing the screen on a premium phone. And thankfully, that novelty doesn't quite wear off when using the Legacy. There's a careful nuance required for discussing budget devices. You know, maybe it's a first phone for a kid, or maybe it's a consumer who needs to maximize the value of every dollar spent. There's no clear answer to the argument between newer cheap phone an older, formerly expensive phone, but these newer, less expensive devices are making good arguments for purpose-built hardware in this price tier. Unless you think this is just a gimmick or a cash grab from a new manufacturer trying to slum it, we're confident the next slate of devices coming our way from Samsung will be refreshed Galaxy A series, starting with an A10e at, wait for it, $179.99. The world's biggest manufacturers taking mid-range and entry-level a lot more seriously, even in first world and developed markets. A segment which was largely kept alive by manufacturers like Motorola, joined by Nokia, but Samsung will have more name recognition in retail space. Between the Galaxy A10e and the CoolPad Legacy at $180, which do you think will get the bigger display, bigger battery, higher resolution camera, and more RAM? I'll give you a hint, it's not gonna be the Samsung. These phones are not about covering the basics. You don't need this screen, battery, or these cameras to cover the basics. Phones like the Legacy are all about making the entry level more livable, making that budget tier a little nicer. I'll of course have some links in the description below where you can find more information on the CoolPad Legacy, maybe shop one of these puppies online. As always, thanks so much for watching, for sharing these videos, subscribing to this channel, and not just freaking out about super expensive gadgets. Can we make it through our day for a little less cash? If you would like to help support the production of those conversations, there are links below, or you could consider joining the list of names scrolling by on your screen. A great and growing community of like-minded tech pals, and a huge resource for me in planning future videos and reviews. I hope you'll check it out. Now, you know where you can find me around the rest of the internet, at SomeGadgetGuy on the Twitters and the Instagrams and the Facebooks and the Twitch, and I will catch you all on the next review.